second lecture for crystal systems. I'm embarrassed to admit it, but last time I felt a little rushed as I worked through crystal systems. So today we're going to go a little slower, perhaps systematically even, as we go through. And in fact, what we'll do to start is I'm just going to pick up a little bit with where we were last time. Within the isometric system, wouldn't it be nice if I could tell you exactly where these different axes sit on a cube? And in fact, that's what I just wanted to do. So we're going to do a couple little notes, picking up right here where you are picturing a cube. And you can either draw this cube, we've done it before, or just look at the pictures. But if we are confronted with a cube, where are the different symmetry elements within our our 4 over m, bar 3, 2 over m, which has so many symmetry elements, 3a4s, 4 bar 3s, right, 6a2s, and 9 mirrors. Where do all of those things sit relative to the axes? And the way that it works is that the axes, a1, a2, and a3, they're each one of the 4 folds. So here in the crystal, we have a 4 fold that comes out here, right? 1A4. And we have another crystal that comes, another A4 here, and another A4 here. Well, in the end, each of these are A, B, and C are A1, A2, A3. So we're going to put A1 here, A2 here, and A3 here. And we could visualize them coming together in the center of the crystal, like so. Well, where do the bar 3s? Well, they end up coming, it's called shooting, like going through the octant. So if it starts here at the center, one comes out there, another comes out here, right? Another comes out here, basically through the corners. So that is where, we'll call it an octant. That's probably beyond the purpose, the level of this class, but that's where our bar 3s exit the crystal. Now what about our other aspects, right? Our A2s. Well, they bisect the angles between the main axes. Well, what does that really actually mean? So they bisect the angle between the main axes. So if we were to put them in red, what's the angle? Oh, come on, red. Here is a main axis and here's a main axis, and we're going to bisect the angle. That means they have to come out the edges. So the A2s come out the edges. And you would see that if you had a block in front of you. And the mirror planes, well, they're called axial planes. And they are also diagonal to the A2s. And so if you put them in, we have to just split the crystal in a whole bunch of different ways. Okay, so those are the symmetry elements relative to those crystallographic axes. Now, the other thing I might have skipped over a little quickly is the tetrahedron. Now, the tetrahedron is a shape that you're very familiar with. I think the Great Pyramid in Egypt is a tetrahedron, and this is a shape made up of triangles. So how do we draw that in 3D? Yeah, something like this, right? Where every single, and there we put in a triangle as well. That's what a tetrahedron looks like. Sphalerite is a very good example of a mineral that has this crystal system. All right, so we can see that here with, where's our triangles? There's one of our triangles. Then there's one we can't see in the frame of the page and one we can't see in the frame of the page. But there's our example of it. And where do the axes work? Well, the axes are on each one of the bar 4s. So what does this have in terms of symmetry? Well, the bar 4, 3m, has 3 bar 4s. It has 4 A3s, and it has 6 mirrors. And we know that the axes have to be perpendicular to one another, and we know that they have to all be the same length. So the axes are each one of the bar 4 rotations. Well, how does that actually work? Well, the bar, oh boy, how do we draw this? We'd need to draw it something like this, kind of upside down. And I can't do that in 3 dimensions very quickly right now, but you'd imagine, like, if here the axis would be coming straight out at your face, or if we rotated it, it would be coming up like this. And that is one of our bar 4s, and it ends up being A1. And then A2 would come out this way, and the other one would come out this way. And they're intersecting at the middle of the edges. The A3s are easier to find, right? So we have four A3s. We have four faces. So the A3s come out of the middle of each of the faces. This is getting in a little too much detail, but it's going to help you find these when you get to see them in person in lab. All right, so there's our isometric class. Now let's just go back and walk through the other crystal systems, going through monoclinic, orthorhombic, and tetragonal today. We'll save hexagonal for the last crystal symmetry lecture. Oh boy, what letter are we on? We were on, let's see, B. C was triclinic, D was isometric, E will be monoclinic. E, monoclinic. We'll draw the axes again, but before we draw the axes, let's just say the simple definition here. Well, here, A does not equal B, which does not equal C. That means all the axes are unequal lengths. Unequal lengths. Think through how you'd have to draw those axes when we start to draw it. And in terms of the angles, we have alpha and gamma are at 90 degrees. Alpha equals gamma, which equals 90 degrees. But beta is greater than 90 degrees. So what is that going to look like? Let's try to draw it over here. We're going to have a C-axis. And then we have a B-axis. That's 90 degrees to that. How do I know that? Because remember, the angle between C and B, let's see, can we find that information quickly? Maybe it's not. Well, that's called alpha. This angle right here is called alpha. And alpha is 90 degrees, we say it there. Okay, now the angle between alpha, between A axis and B axis, we haven't drawn an A axis yet. Let's go ahead and put that in there. All right, it goes to the back. This angle here is gamma, and it also has to be 90 degrees. But then the angle between C and A, this angle right here, that angle is greater than 90 degrees. So we kind of get this downward tilt of the A, whereas these other two are at 90 degrees. The crystal class that we care about here is 2 over m. And what 2 over m has, it has a center of symmetry, it has one A2, and it has one mirror plane. Let's see, do I have a good example of that to show you? Oh my gosh, I didn't. I didn't put up a picture of gypsum or clinopyroxene or one of the micas. Can I draw it for you quickly? Almost certainly not. Maybe I'll just have to say, go take a look at the textbook and you'll find it. No, I can do better than that. Let's scroll back up here to the top. Here we go. Let's look at this example of the monoclinic crystal. What do we see here? We see one angle that I've drawn in before, right, when I was introducing this to you. Now we see that that angle is indeed 90 degrees. We see this angle here is 90 degrees, and the angle between C and A, look at that. See how it's tilting down, and even this face is tilting down, it is going to be greater than 90 degrees. There's our monoclinic system. When we put in the folds, we can do this too, and I'll write it down there below. But if we want to find the mirror plane, we say stuff like, the A axis is declined towards the front. The C axis is vertical. And they both lie on the mirror plane. That means in a monoclinic crystal, the mirror plane kind of comes through there in the crystal, right? You can kind of see how that bisects the crystal. And the twofold axis is the B axis. Okay, that means the B here, this is our A2. So that's how you look to find symmetry in a monoclinic crystal. Okay, that worked out pretty good. Let's go to the next highest degree of symmetry. And in this one, I'll promise you, I'll show a mineral. In fact, let's start with it. oh, I forgot what letter this is. This is F. F is going to be our orthorhombic system. F. Orthorhombic. We'll throw in a picture here to start. We'll go with sulfur, a beautiful example of an orthorhombic crystal. And we can use this to think about lengths of axes, etc. Another thing you could think about with orthorhombic system is a cereal box, because it's an orthorhombic crystal. So for orthorhombic, the axes are all unequal lengths. So A does not equal B, does not equal C. We go all unequal. But our angles now all are the same, and they're all 90 degrees. So we will put in here that alpha equals beta, which equals gamma, which equals 90 degrees. That's the important rule that I want you to memorize so that you can immediately visualize what this needs to look like. Let's make this be, as we draw our axes, we're going to draw like a tall cereal box with a very long C-axis and a short B-axis and a moderate A-axis. So there's our A, B, and our C's, and importantly, they're all intersecting each other at 90 degrees, 90 degrees, and 90 degrees. If we were to put this into one of these crystals, well, I suppose what we would do is we could say, well, the C-axis is probably coming along here, and we've got one an A there, and another A is shooting out this face right here. Okay, and we can see that there's 90 degrees in the sulfur. Now, C does not have to be longer. C can be longer or shorter than A and B. Right? You can have a crystal that's very tall, like the one we've maybe drawn here, or we can have a short and stubby crystal. All of those things are fine. Now, in our orthorhombic system, the crystal class that we care about is the 2 over M, 2 over M, 2 over M. And this has center of symmetry, 3 A2s, and 3 mirrors. And where do you find those features? Well, I guess we could, should we just draw in a cereal box real quick? Let's draw in a cereal box. You don't need that shooting noises, do you? I'll stop that. If we draw in our cereal box, make yours a little neater than mine. The C-axis is often chosen as the one with the most elongation. So this one's tall, so most likely we're going to put the C through the tallest one, and that is going to be an A2. In fact, all of our axes here are A2s. So how do we say that? Well, I guess we say that our A2s align with axes. That's pretty easy to find. And the A and B axes typically lie on the mirror planes, and that's kind of pretty easy to see here. So all of the axes also lie and correspond with the mirror planes. Another way to say that would also be like the mirror planes bisect the faces. Mirrors bisect faces. If you have something quite as simple as this, but you can do the same thing here. Where are the mirror planes in our olivine crystals? Well, the mirror planes bisect the main faces, and our crystallographic axes, that one's coming straight out of the page towards us. We'd have another one in this direction and another one in this direction. That's orthorhombic system. Now let's go to letter G, and that'll be the last crystal system we talk about today, saving hexagonal for last, and that will be tetragonal. I bet you can guess the tetragonal system is the one that's going to include our A4s, and that is definitely the case. There are two different crystal classes we're going to worry about in the tetragonal system. One is the 4 over M, 2 over M, 2 over M, and the other is the bar 4, 2 M. The bar 4, 2 over M, let's just go ahead and spell out the symmetry elements that these things have. Well, this one has a center of symmetry, 1 A4, five mirrors, four A2s. Five mirrors. And I forgot to write in my notes all the symmetry elements that the bar 42M has, but you have them in your notes, and I'll just say, go check your notes. Maybe even pause this video and just go fill it in. When all the crystal classes that we care about in tetragonal have the same axes law. And our axes that we have to worry about, they are all A equals B, which does not equal C. And so sometimes, like in the textbook, because A and B are equal to one another in terms of their lengths, they'll just say A1 equals A2, which does not equal C. And C can either be longer or shorter than A and B, making a short stubby crystal. Here, right? This will be, is stubby a technical word? Of course not. Or we could have like elongate crystals. And then when we draw in our angles, it's easy because they're all 90 degrees. And so we will say here that alpha equals beta, which equals gamma, which equals 90, right? They all have to be 90 degrees. So if we were to draw this in, we could say like so. This is C, this is A1, and coming at 90 degrees to it is A2. A1 and A2 are the same length, and the angles between these are 90, 90, and 90. We could do the same thing over here. Here we have a short and stubby C. We can draw in an A1 and an A2 of equal length, and they are all intersecting at 90. So those are our possibilities for our axes with tetragonal. To identify a tetragonal mineral quickly, just visualize the length of those axes and the angles between it. Let's actually give it a try here in person with this zircon image. Zircon is a tetragonal mineral. It's 4 over M, 2 over M, 2 over M. And as we picture this, I just want you to think, okay, there's an axis here, that's the C, and then we have one shooting out here and another shooting out here. It's 90 degrees to one another, and that's 90 degrees to that. That's got to be tetragonal. We're going to try to train your brain to think that way. And so when we see a tetragonal 4 over M, 2 over M, 2 over M, where do these different symmetry elements lie? Well, I'll tell you this, that the A tends to be the C axis. All right, we just see it here, so we could say, so this tends to be the A4. Well, it has to be it. Two of the A2s, so two of the A2s line up on A1 and A2. So we have an A2 that lines up directly on that axis. We also have another A2 that lines up on that axis. And the other two A2s are at 45 degrees to that. So there would be another A2 at the 45 mark, and another A2, let's see, it would be here, A2. Okay, so that's how you find your four A2s. And then the mirrors are on the planes with each of the rotations. Well, it just means the mirrors line up real nice, right? So there'd be a mirror, and there'd be a mirror. Just any place where there is an A2 or an A4, we're going to find mirror planes. Maybe the harder shape to deal with is this bar 42M. Let me show you what a bar 42M shape looks like. It's kind of a weird one. The mineral that makes this shape is called, well, probably the most famous is chalcopyrite. Right, one of those fool's gold variants. And I'm going to use this. If you want to try to draw this shape, you can. But let's say this. The bar 4 is the C-axis. It's the same here. And in this case, it's right here. It comes out like this. So our C-axis would project down through the crystal like so. And this is the C, and it's also our, let's see, do it like this. Bar 4. The twofold axes, right, because it's 2M, they lie on the A1 and the A2. And so this would be, let's see, think I shouldn't be stalling here in the middle of class, but we'll just write it down here. The A2 lie on the A1 and A2 axes, and the mirror planes are vertical, right? So they parallel the C-axis. So the mirrors are vertical. Oh yeah, let's just put one last note here. Chalcopyrite as example. What other kind of little brief stats could we put down? Oh, I told you that 2% of triclinic minerals, or 2% of minerals are triclinic. Tetragonal holds 12% of all minerals. And orthorhombic, these are more common. This is 20% of all minerals are orthorhombic. About 20%, okay? And then isometric, oh, monoclinic, I forgot about you. 21% of crystals, of minerals, sorry, are monoclinic. And isometric is 26. About 26% of minerals are this. All right, that's the end. We'll do hexagonal system for the last crystal systems lecture. See you then.